I'm Rick Graber, president of the Bradley Foundation. Welcome once again to We the People, a Bradley speaker series. America's labor crisis is affecting all of us in our daily lives. Longer lines at the checkout, longer waits at restaurants, reduced hours at retail stores, lack of transportation to schools and athletic events, just to name a few. And for businesses large and small, it's making a post-COVID bounce back even more difficult. And for those industries hit hardest by the pandemic, such as hospitality, such as leisure, the worker shortage has been nothing short of acute. In our return to the We the People series, our guest today offers a perspective on America's labor shortage that you'd really be hard-pressed to find in the mainstream media. Noah Williams is the founding director of the Center for Research on the Wisconsin Economy, sometimes known as CROW. He's the Curtin Sue Culver Professor of Economics at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He's an adjunct fellow at the Manhattan Institute. Previously, Noah was on the faculty at Princeton University. He's published widely and co-authored several papers with Nobel Prize recipients Lars Peter Hansen and Thomas Sargent. Noah received his undergraduate degree and PhD from the University of Chicago. Welcome, Noah. It's great to have you.
Yeah, happy to be with you.
Noah, let's dive right in. And let's start with a historical perspective on the labor crisis. Here in Milwaukee, as in other cities, the situation really seems pretty dire. For example, the Milwaukee Public School District recently approved a plan to actually offer money to families driving their kids to school because of a bus driver shortage. How does the current labor shortage compare to those of the past?
Yeah, it's really unlike anything that we've ever seen before. Typically, there's a relationship between job openings and unemployment. When unemployment is high, job openings are low, and vice versa. And we've really seen what's very different now is unemployment is essentially stalled out while job openings have gone through the roof. So, here in the state, we had a very tight labor market in 2019. But by many measures, we're well beyond that now. Unemployment is still elevated relative to pre-pandemic levels. So it's this combination of demand for workers out there, businesses looking to hire, survey measures of unemployment still being relatively high, but we're just not seeing the availability of workers. So it's really on the supply side.
The United States has a record number of job openings that employers are clearly struggling to fill. What you read about in the narrative is that people aren't returning to work for a variety of reasons. They're afraid of COVID, decision to change careers, lack of childcare, just wanting more out of a job. You've got a little bit different take on that. And you wrote about that in an article in National Review recently called When Unemployment Begets Unemployment. Share some takeaways from that article.
Sure. I do think all those factors that are widely mentioned, are important. But I think what we've seen, and we've seen it in other countries before, is if you subsidize unemployment for an extended period of time, it's very difficult to get people back to work. Right. So during the pandemic, the federal government topped up state unemployment insurance programs, initially $600 a week, and then later for an extended period, $300 a week. That meant, even recently, as many as 40% of people who were unemployed earned more on unemployment than they did while they were on the job. And this persisted for about 18 months. So once someone is unemployed for 18 months, they've lost touch with their previous employer, their skills have declined, they've lost the motivation in many cases, the soft skills, getting up in the morning, showing up, going back to work. All of that has made it more difficult to get people back to work. And I mentioned the federal unemployment insurance benefits, but that's only one of the many, the vast fiscal expansion we've seen, all of which have given people more of an incentive to stay home, or at least haven't provided an incentive to go back to work. So that's really, even though the federal unemployment insurance benefits have gone away now, finally, some states ended them early, but the federal subventions ended around Labor Day. People have been living with this for so long. It's what in economics we call hysteresis, where a short-term effect can have a permanent or very long-lasting effect. I think we're seeing the impact of that right now.
So we just thought things would immediately snap back when those benefits ended. And that just hasn't been the case, to your point.
No, that's true. And, you know, I mentioned the unemployment insurance benefits, but I think if we take kind of a broader picture, we haven't seen fiscal expansion and government transfers of this size or this scale before. So if you look in the 17 months leading up to April 2020, and then look at the 17 months afterwards, transfer payments have increased by about 50%, 47% to be precise over that time. And they've accounted for 30% of people's incomes. So even though the federal unemployment insurance benefits have gone away, people are sitting on, you know, we had the rounds of stimulus payments. We've had the child tax credit payments, which are going out monthly now. All of that has increased savings substantially. So people are sitting on a larger stock of savings. Again, there's a distribution here. Not everyone is, of course, doing this, but on average. So people aren't, you know, as motivated or aren't, you know, don't find it as necessary to get back to work.
We've all been watching the seemingly endless debate in Washington in recent weeks. The Biden administration is clearly trying to expand the entitlement state by proposing cradle-to-grave federal benefits. They've already expanded the federal child tax credit, even to families with higher incomes. If they're successful, and they might be, and they probably will be to some extent, how does that impact America's long-term economic health?
So I think in two ways. One is just kind of the direct budget cost of it, right? So we take the, you know, we've already allocated during this crisis, you know, $5.2 trillion in extra government spending. There's another $1 trillion in the infrastructure program. You know, some of that going to useful purposes, some of it not. And then $1.8 trillion in the Build Back Better plan, in the at least the latest version. So that's about $8 trillion in extra spending, which is about an extra full year of government spending. Right? So basically doubling. Again, you know, this is extended over a 10-year horizon. So we're already, you know, facing record levels of debt and deficits. This would just be layering that on top of our existing stock of debt, which means, you know, going forward, we're looking at increases in taxes for the foreseeable future. Something which is unsustainable at some point has to end. And these deficit levels really are unsustainable. So that's one aspect of it, is just the cost of it. But also, I think maybe more importantly, is what it does to the nature of people's life, people's experience. I've already talked a little bit about how these programs have really gotten us away from, or really devalued the culture of work, which we've had in this country. So what we're seeing now is an expansion of federal programs which aren't tied to work, aren't in their universal programs, and they also go much higher up the income scale than previously. So I think that's kind of doubly costly in the sense that, one, we're not incentivizing people to work, and at the same time, there's a saying in social policy that a program for the poor is a poor program. So by expanding the base of people who are getting these government benefits, that may be politically make it more costly to reverse them in the future.
Does the loss of dignity that comes from not working play into other issues, crime, drug abuse?
Yes, definitely. It's there's a whole host of, you know, social pathologies which are associated with the non-attachment to the labor force, as I would say it, but not being involved in the labor force. And I think one of the most concerning trends we've seen over the past decade or 15 years, particularly, deals with young men who are, you know, out of high school, not going to school, or not attached to the labor force. And associated with this non-attachment to the labor force is increased crime, increased dependency, drug use, out of wedlock births, all of that has gone up, and government dependence, to be frank. So I'll, work is only one aspect of it, but work is kind of, the fundamental, you know, driving force for a lot of these other features.
So in the early months of the pandemic, I think we all were afraid of another Great Depression. We were seeing mass layoffs. So, it just seems so ironic now that quite the opposite has happened, that businesses are dangling as many incentives as they possibly can to get people to sign up and go to work for them. Is there anything that employers can or should be doing, or is it just impossible to compete with the entitlement state?
Certainly very difficult. And you often see a cheap retort, well, just raise your wages, right? But this isn't like true competition. This isn't two businesses in competition where productivity is going to drive wage increases. This is, you know, artificial, support put up by the federal government. We have seen businesses become quite creative. Again, a number of them, wages have gone up, particularly on the low end, where this competition with government benefits is most severe. We've seen hiring bonuses and sign-on bonuses. We've also seen businesses adopt kind of broader strategies, reaching out to populations which hadn't been reached before. We saw some of that here as well in the state in 2019. Ex-offenders being one. A lot of businesses are clamoring to hire up ex-military. When people get out of the military, they often have jobs directly. And I guess one other thing is businesses are reducing requirements for entry, doing much more training on the job, reducing education requirements, all of that just basically to get more bodies, showing up to even apply for these jobs.
Noah, last question. What are some policy solutions to the labor shortage? You've cited earned income tax credits to low-income adults as one option. Can you expand on that? Are there other ideas?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the earned income tax credit has been one of the more successful anti-poverty programs because it doesn't have this adverse incentive effect. In fact, quite the opposite. It provides an additional, it's essentially like a negative income tax. If you work, you get a little additional supplement from the government. I think that's useful. I think, more broadly, we've seen a lot of, restrictions overall on the supply side, whether that's zoning and construction and building new housing, things which are tying people to current locations, like job licensing requirements. A lot of the benefits people do get are tied to locations. We're seeing just less mobility overall. So when there are opportunities, people are less willing or less able to move to those opportunities. So I think longer term, we need to think about loosening up some of these restrictions and allowing more freedom to move.
Great. Noah Williams, thanks so much for your time today. Thanks for the great work that you and your team at Crow are doing. And of course, thanks to all of you for joining us on this episode of We the People.